The multi-radar, multi-sensor system represents a method of assimilating data from several sources to generate products that can be used to enhance a forecaster's assessment of developing hazardous weather events. Researchers at the National Severe Storms Laboratory have been developing MRMS for many years. In 2014, the National Weather Service added the MRMS catalog of products to its official decision support toolset. Its usage has grown steadily among NWS forecasters, and we'd like to take this opportunity to champion its value as a resource for communicating information to the public by broadcast media and private sector partners. So, what is it exactly? MRMS is a single four-dimensional grid of information created by integrating data from radars, satellites, surface and upper air observations, lightning networks, and numerical model output. Its grid spans the contiguous United States as well as parts of southern Canada. Every 2 minutes, MRMS builds a collection of mosaicked products, many of which have proven to be valuable tools for improving situational awareness, informing critical forecast decisions, and conveying important insights about potential hazards and impacts to core partners. Because they're composed from multiple inputs, MRMS products can offer a more complete picture of the current weather than single-source displays. For example, consider this image of vertically integrated liquid, or VIL, from a WSR-88D radar, cut through the cross-section depicted in the lower left. Note there are several data void areas owing to gaps between radar beams. In addition, a significant portion of the storm was never sampled because of its proximity to the radar. Now compare that image with the corresponding MRMS product, comprised of data from three adjacent radars. This method produces a more complete depiction of vertical storm structure, thanks to the integration of different inputs by the MRMS system. Similar benefits can be achieved on the horizontal scale, as illustrated on this plan view comparison. The multiple radar integration mitigates data loss associated with the cone of silence. There are literally hundreds of MRMS products to choose from, but let's focus our attention on three that will serve to demonstrate potential value to a diverse set of users. On days when there are many developing storms to monitor, one of the challenges forecasters face is conducting triage, especially if the area of interest encompasses multiple radar domains. In those situations, one of the products that forecasters find helpful is isothermal reflectivity at minus 10 C. This product is generated by finding the reflectivity value at minus 10 degrees Celsius using the 3D mesoscale temperature profile from the high-resolution rapid refresh model. Research has shown that high reflectivities at temperatures colder than minus 10 C infer an increasing likelihood of severe hail, especially values greater than about 50 dBZ. Interrogating this product makes it easy to identify the strongest cores and determine which ones to focus on first for potential severe weather. In this example, from 1 May 2018, several thunderstorms were developing in the vicinity of a cold front from southern Nebraska through central Kansas. Reflectivity at lowest altitude revealed several cells that exhibited high reflectivity values, as shown in this display. If this line was developing in your forecast area, or your media market, determining which thunderstorms posed the greatest immediate threat could be partially resolved by looking at the corresponding MRMS isothermal reflectivity product. In this case, two of the Kansas storms are indicating high reflectivity cores at minus 10 C, suggesting they might be the best cells to focus on first using single radar interrogation techniques. Toggling back and forth between those two displays makes it easy to see why this product can be useful for conducting triage when many storms are developing in your area simultaneously. Of course, every dataset has limitations. In the case of MRMS, it's important to note that the 1 kilometer grid spacing of its reflectivity products is not as fine as the resolution of WSR-88D SuperRes data. In addition, the QC process that eliminates most non-meteorological returns from these products sometimes removes details that can be important to a meteorologist, such as low-level boundaries, as illustrated here. Features like three-body scatter spikes and side lobes are also commonly removed or reduced. Despite these caveats, the value of these products outweighs their shortcomings. Another product that has become popular among forecasters is Maximum Estimated Size of Hail, or MESH. MESH is derived from radar-observed reflectivity values combined with 3D temperature and moisture profiles from the HER. It can be displayed as an instantaneous field, or as a 60-minute track, or both. It is, of course, subject to the accuracy and representativeness of the HER model output. Also, there are known biases in its predictive performance, including underestimation for highly tilted storms, left-moving supercells, and storms with a large bounded weak echo region. Nevertheless, MESH has, on many occasions, provided a useful precursor signal of large hail producers. On the afternoon of May 14, 2018, MESH tracks indicated increasing hail size estimates in association with a supercell crossing the Colorado border into western Kansas. Single radar interrogation revealed storm structure that corroborated a high probability of significant hail, and a severe thunderstorm warning was issued. MESH tracks continued to indicate a swath of large hail for almost an hour. The trend peaked at around 0028 UTC, with the MESH signaling potential for hail greater than 3 inches in diameter. Multiple reports of hail greater than 2 inches in diameter were received between 2332 and 0035 UTC, the largest being hailstones 3 inches in diameter in the vicinity of Weskin, Kansas at 0005 UTC. Superimposing MESH tracks on the GOES-16 0.64 micron visible image reveals this storm also displayed a prominent overshooting top and above anvil plume. Research has shown strong correlations between these features and severe weather. If you look closely, you can see the hail swath on the ground in the wake of the storm. Thus far, we've concentrated on reflectivity-based MRMS products. There are also products based on the velocity moment of the WSR-88D radar. The one most commonly used in operations is probably low-level rotation tracks. The low-level rotation tracks product is created by plotting all the 0 to 2 kilometer azimuthal shear values over a 1 hour period. Azimuthal shear is simply rotational velocity divided by distance. Rotation tracks show a history of intensity, location, and spatial coverage of circulations that may be associated with mesocyclones, tornadoes, or damaging winds, as well as strong boundary layer shear zones. During the evening of May 1, 2018, the MRMS low-level rotation tracks plot provided a clear indication of persistent low-level circulation attending a supercell in north-central Kansas. Recognizing this type of trend, combined with single dual-pole radar analysis and awareness of the near-storm environment, are critical considerations for tornado threat assessment. A tornado warning was in effect for this area, issued by the National Weather Service Office in Topeka. A strong low-level rotation signal persisted over the next several volume scans with extremely high azimuthal shear values at 0106 UTC. Superimposing the 0.5 degree reflectivity provides a better appreciation for the overall plan view structure of the storm at this time. At approximately 8 p.m. Central Daylight Time, or 0100 UTC, a spotter photographed this tornado in farmland between the towns of Tescott and Culver, Kansas. Based on a damage survey conducted the following day, the tornado was probably EF2 at the time of the photograph, although some EF3 rated damage was identified farther north along the 14-mile-long track. An interesting outcome of that survey was that the tornado track turned out to be associated with the left turn in the rotation path. This evolution actually provides a useful teaching moment to help users better understand what the azimuthal shear products represent. The most critical point to realize is this. What is transpiring at the surface may not be directly reflected by the azimuthal shear signatures displayed within MRMS rotational tracks. In this case, evidence suggests that a tornado formed as the mesocyclone occluded. In this process, the circulation contracted such that the MRMS rotational component, while still quite vigorous, was unable to resolve the intense near-surface circulation. In addition, as the supercell recycled, a deep strengthening mesocyclone formed in association with the new updraft. This could draw the attention of a forecaster as the one most likely to be a tornado producer. But all one can accurately deduce is that the circulation aloft remains very strong and may serve to amplify the near-surface vorticity for possible tornado genesis. One final artifact of interest with respect to this product is the occasional appearance of gaps in the circulation track plots. This pattern, sometimes called the heartbeat effect, is associated with brief intermittent loss of data due to differences in scan times between adjacent radars. It's most noticeable for fast-moving storms or when only one radar is sampling the storm system. The key thing to remember is that the heartbeat effect is not indicative that a circulation is pulsing. It's simply a consequence of discontinuous sampling. These are just a few of the products that could add real value to on-air communication of weather-related threats and potential impacts. It's important to stress that MRMS is not intended to replace single radar dual pole products. But as a complement to those data, this product suite can provide significant value by filling in gaps where traditional radar coverage is lacking. And now that GOES-16 is operational, forecasters are experimenting with ways to interrogate radar data and MRMS products alongside high-resolution satellite imagery and probabilistic decision aids. This will undoubtedly be a growing area of interest and research for efforts to improve the timeliness and quality of convective warnings over the next few years. If you would like to experiment with these data, there are several ways to access them. Here's a list of some sites where MRMS products can be found. If you'd like to learn more about MRMS products and their applications for forecasting, I recommend exploring training resources from the National Weather Service Warning Decision Training Division. Many excellent modules are available at their website. In summary, by creating products that use sophisticated techniques to integrate data from multiple sources, the MRMS suite offers unique value to forecasters. MRMS provides a more comprehensive picture of the current weather that can be used to improve a forecaster's environmental awareness and critical decision-making. These benefits make MRMS an excellent resource for our partners in broadcast media, emergency management, and private sector companies to enhance their communication of pending weather-related threats to the public.